And for us big kids, I'd like for us to turn in our Bibles to the book of Daniel. The book of Daniel, yeah. Daniel chapter 1. I want you to know that as your pastor, I often seek God's, not often, I always seek God on what to preach about. And you know, we just finished a series that took us, I think, about 2 years in the book of Revelation. And as I was praying, it just seemed that it's so appropriate to follow that up with a preaching series in the book of Daniel, because they really do go hand in hand. And it's been a while since I've had a chance to run through the pages of Daniel, and it's one of my favorite books in the Bible. So let's turn in our Bibles to Daniel chapter 1. But before we look at God's word, let us pray. Father God, we come to you in Jesus' name, and we ask that you would just anoint the scriptures to our understanding. We pray that you would bless us. Father God, we ask that your Holy Spirit would give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts to receive whatever it is that you want to give to us from this passage today. Father, we know that this is a great book of prophecy. We know that Daniel was a faithful man of God. And Lord, we want to look at this man through the eyes of faith, Lord Jesus, because we know he served you well. And Father, I ask in Jesus' name that his example would spur us on to be obedient to you, to walk in faith, to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit. And we just thank you for this opportunity in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Daniel chapter 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with some of the articles of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar to the house of his God. And he brought the articles into the treasure house of his God. Then the king instructed Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, to bring some of the children of Israel and some of the king's descendants and some of the nobles, young men in whom there was no blemish, but good-looking, gifted in all wisdom, possessing knowledge and quick to understand, who had ability to serve in the king's palace, whom they might teach the language and literature of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed for them a daily provision of the king's delicacies and of the wine which he drank, and 3 years of training for them, so that at the end of their time they might serve before the king. Now among those of the sons of Judah were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. To them the chief of the eunuchs gave names. He gave Daniel the name Belteshazzar, to Hananiah Shadrach, to Mishael Meshach, and to Azariah Abednego. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's delicacies, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the chief of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Now God had brought Daniel into the favor and goodwill of the chief of the eunuchs. And the chief of the eunuchs said to him, "Daniel, I fear my lord the king, who has appointed your food and drink. For why should he see your faces looking worse than the young men who are your age? Then you would endanger my head before the king." So Daniel said to the steward whom he, the chief of the eunuchs, had set over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, "Please test your servants for 10 days, and let them give us vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then let our appearance be examined before you, and the appearance of the young men who eat of the portion of the king's delicacies. And as you see fit, so deal with your servants." So he consented with them in this matter and tested them 10 days. And at the end of 10 days, their features appeared better and fatter in flesh than all the young men who ate the portion of the king's delicacies. Thus the steward took away their portion of the delicacies and the wine that they were to drink and gave them vegetables. For these 4 young men, God gave them knowledge and skill in all literature and wisdom. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. We'll stop there for now. The historical context of this passage, it's the year 606 BC. Nebuchadnezzar, who is not yet the king, leads an army against Pharaoh Necho. Egypt and Babylon were battling for world supremacy at this time. And Nebuchadnezzar, with the command of the armies of Babylon, defeats Pharaoh Necho in the Battle of Carchemish in 606 BC. On his way back from defeating Pharaoh Necho, he sees Jerusalem and he besieges it and he takes it over. And he captures Jehoiakim and he fetters him. He puts him in chains, but then he releases him to be a vassal king. He says, okay, boy, you work for me. And so Jehoiakim is now serving the king of Babylon, or Nebuchadnezzar. And while Nebuchadnezzar is besieging Jerusalem, word comes to him that his father has died. And so he goes from being commander of the armies to being the king. He puts Jehoiakim in charge of Jerusalem, and he goes back to Babylon. But in doing so, he carries away captives, because that's what the Babylonians did. When they captured a people, they would gather up the best, the sons of the kings, the king, the sons of nobles. They would get the best, the cream of the crop, and they would bring them as hostages back to Babylon, and they would begin to indoctrinate them in the ways of Babylon. And so I'm here to tell you that the title of my message is this: God, our judge. That's the title of my message. God is our judge. And you would say, Nelson, why did God give Jehoiakim into the hands of Nebuchadnezzar? Wasn't Jehoiakim a son of David? Was he not of the lineage and of the house of David? Yes, he was. But a few kings prior, King Hezekiah, in the book of Isaiah, he did a very foolish thing, and you'll have to read the book of Isaiah to find out for yourself. I'm not going to spoon feed you everything. And because of Hezekiah's foolishness, God told Hezekiah through the prophet, the king of Babylon is going to come in and take your sons captive and carry your sons off into captivity in Babylon. This is not the first time that God told Israel that the Babylonians were going to come and conquer them. You can find that all throughout the book of Isaiah. You can find it out through the book of Jeremiah, and you can find it in other books. And so this is what's happened. It is time for God to fulfill his word. Now, we as human beings, we always want to hear the good words. We want to hear the good words. We don't want to hear the tough words. But I'm here to tell you that God has given us his word. Whether it's a tough word or a good word, it's his word, and it's faithful and true. And so, by looking at this from the view of God, I think we need to kind of take a look at, you know, God's viewpoint. What was God's vantage point from this? How does God prove that he is God? Okay? There are many, many so-called gods, especially in this time. There were many false gods. So how did the God of the Bible prove that he was God? And I believe the way that he proved that he was God was by pouring out his spirit upon mankind, but also by showing that he knows everything. He knows all of human history. He knows what was going to happen in the beginning of human history. He knows what's going to happen in the middle of all of human history. And he knows how human history is going to end. And how does he do that? Through prophecy. Through taking human history and recording it in a book before it happens. And that's what the book of Daniel is. Daniel is the most verified book in the Old Testament, in my opinion. It is a book of prophecy. Jesus himself called Daniel a prophet. So if you've got a problem with Daniel being a prophet, you need to take it up with Jesus. Jesus called him a prophet. And so that's good enough for me. I'm not going to argue the fact, but there are those who want to argue the fact whether Daniel is a prophecy. In fact, liberal scholars will try to tell you that this book was the late date this. They'll say things like, well, it couldn't have been written by one person because we know for a fact that this book has some unique features to it. First of all, chapter 1 through chapter 2, verse 3 is written in Hebrew. But then in chapter 2, verse 4, it shifts from Hebrew to Aramaic. And from chapter 2, verse 4, all the way to the end of chapter 7, it's written in Aramaic. Hebrew, of course, was the language of the Jews. Aramaic was the language of the Gentiles. That's what the Gentiles spoke of. And when you take a look at this book, whenever God wanted to focus upon the Jewish nation, he would use Hebrew. Whenever he wanted to focus upon the Gentile world, he would use Aramaic. The Aramaic ends at the end of chapter 7, and beginning with chapter 8, verse 1, all the way through the end, it goes back to Hebrew. And so what this shows us is that there is a certain focus in each section of this Bible. Also, there's a smattering of some Greek and Persian words. And so because of this unique feature, the liberal scholars will say, there's no way Daniel wrote this. Oh, really? Well, let me ask you this. Could Daniel read and write Hebrew? He was in the court. He was a noble. You know, if not part of the royal line, he was part of the nobility. I think he could read and write Hebrew. Could he read and write Aramaic? Well, he is called into Babylon and he spends 3 years learning Babylonian literature, science, and art. So I'm pretty sure he knew how to read and write Aramaic as well. We say, well, what about the Persian and Greek words in it? Well, as we look at Daniel, he's going to rise like cream to the top. And he's going to end up being the second most powerful man in the, not only in the Babylonian Empire, but also in the Persian Empire. And being an important man in the Babylonian Empire, he obviously would have had dealings with Greeks and Persians, so he probably learned a few Persian and Greek words just like any international traveler would. And so what happens here is these liberal scholars, they have no reason to believe what they believe. They just don't have any faith. And here's the key. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Without faith, it is impossible to see God's plan. Jesus made an astounding remark to his disciples in John chapter 15 when he was getting ready to go on the cross. And then eventually, 50 days later, he was going to ascend to the Father's throne and stuff. He was preparing the disciples to run this thing called the church, okay? And what did he do? He said to them, he said, look, I no longer call you servants. I call you friends. Because a servant doesn't know what his master is doing, but I'm going to show you what I'm going to do. Now, there are some pastors out there that avoid Bible prophecy like a plague. Because it is a controversial topic. People get upset about Bible prophecy. They get really worked up about different views in Bible prophecy. And I'm here to tell you, I have a very strong, which I think a very biblical view of Bible prophecy. But I'm here to tell you that all Scripture is God-breathed. We can't avoid the hard words of God because it makes us uncomfortable. We can't avoid preaching the whole counsel of God because we want to avoid controversy. Just the opposite. What does the Bible tell us? It tells that those of us who preached Jesus Christ and Him crucified are a stumbling block to some and foolish to others. The cross of Jesus Christ causes offense. But in this, you know, 21st century America, we're so worried about not offending people. Oh, I can't offend anyone. And if I do offend them, then the offended have more rights than the non-offended. No, they don't. Guess what? There's a time to be offended. If you're a sinner and you don't know you're a sinner, you need to know that you're a sinner. Now, who wants to be called a sinner? Raise your hand. Anyone here want to be called a sinner? No, I don't want to be called a sinner. And it might be offensive to me, okay? But you know what? It saved my life. Because it made me know that I needed a Savior. It let me know I was in trouble. And unfortunately, I believe Satan has successfully pulled that out of the church. We don't want to offend anyone. Now, I'm not saying that we go out of our way to offend. We don't need to be jerks. God, there's no ministry of being a jerk, okay? There's no ministry of being obnoxious. There's no gift of the Spirit that says, I have the gift of obnoxiousness. No, okay? But understand this. If you preach God, if you preach His Word, you will irritate people. People will get upset with you. You need to understand that. Okay, and I don't know why I went there, but getting back to this text, God is our judge. In fact, Daniel's name means God is my judge. You know what? God bless you. You know, God is our judge. God is our judge. You're not my judge. You're my brothers and sisters. You can help me so I don't get judged, okay? And I'm not your judge either. Not my place to judge you. Not my job to judge you. It's my job to preach to you, to teach the Word of God to you, to hopefully exhort you to do the right things. That's my job. And it's also my job to be a fisher of men. It doesn't say I'm a catcher of men. It just says I'm a fisher of men. Because believe me, I've gone on many fishing trips where I came back with nothing. Nothing, honey. Okay? And then there have been other fishing trips where, ooh, you know, full of fish, all kinds of fish. And that's what we are. We're fishers of men, not catchers of men. And we're going to take a look at a very expert fisher of men in this man, Daniel. And my thesis is this: God is the one who brings us into favor. And we're going to see this spelled out in Daniel's life. God is the one who is going to bring Daniel into favor. Now, a lot of people might say, well, Nelson, why should we pay attention to Daniel? And I'm here to tell you that we should pay attention to the book of Daniel because it is a book of prophecy. And how God thinks about prophecy, turn with me in your Bibles. Keep your finger in Daniel chapter 1. We're going to go into the New Testament here for a minute. I want us to go into 2 Peter chapter 1, beginning with verse 19. We're going to see how God views Bible prophecy. What does the Bible say about Bible prophecy? Okay? Because, you know, preacher, you're telling me Bible prophecy is important. Well, who are you, preacher, to tell me that? Okay? You're right. Who am I to tell you that? Okay? Unless I'm echoing the Word of God, I have no right to tell you anything. Really? Okay? But in verse 19 of 2 Peter chapter 1, it says this. Actually, let's go up to verse 18. Let's go up to verse 16 to give it a little bit of context. Verse 16. This is Peter. Put this in context. Peter is at the end of his ministry. Okay? Peter is the one who saw Jesus Christ glorified on the Mount of Transfiguration. And he's going to talk about that. Okay? And this is what he says. He says, "For we did not follow cunningly devised fables when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when such a voice came to him from the excellent glory, 'This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased.'" And if recall, on the Mount of Transfiguration, what happened there? Peter, James, and John, the inner circle, were praying with Jesus, and then all of a sudden, Moses and Elijah show up, shining, and Jesus, and they're illuminated by the glory of God, and it's the Feast of Booths, and Peter's all excited, and he goes, "Lord, should we build a booth for you and for Elijah and for Moses?" And the Father says, "This is my beloved Son, listen to him." It was God's way of saying, "Shut up, Peter." And Peter is recalling that story. And he says, I was an eyewitness of this. How many of us would want to be an eyewitness? Wouldn't that be awesome? Oh yeah, I would have loved to have seen that. But notice what Peter says, okay? It says, "And we heard this voice which came from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. And so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed as a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star arises in your heart. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation, for prophecy never came by the will of men, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit." Now there's a false teaching out in the body of Christ. And that teaching is, well, there are many interpretations of biblical prophecy. You know, you have your interpretation, I have my interpretation, she has her interpretation, this one has their interpretation, let's do our interpretation dance, you know, and just agree to disagree agreeably, okay? And I'm not against agreeing to disagree agreeably, but I'm here to tell you that there is only one interpretation, okay? There's only one interpretation. There's not four interpretations to every prophecy. There's one interpretation. Now, it's the Word of God. It's alive and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. There are an infinite number of applications. Application is not interpretation. There's only one interpretation, one. And you say, well, preacher, how do you best protect yourself from getting a wrong interpretation of Bible prophecy? And I'm here to tell you the best way is to use Scripture to interpret Scripture. That is the best way. And that is called the context of the whole. That's part one. The other part is look at the historical time period and look at who it was written to and why it was written to. That's called the historical context. And then, of course, the most important context, I think, is the exegetical context. In other words, what is the whole passage that you're reading from trying to tell you? Too many times I see people pick this scripture and this scripture and this scripture, and they pull three scriptures out of context, and they come up with an interpretation. And that just won't do. Just will not do. And you know, and if you know anything about our Bible studies, when we're studying any book, you know, whether we're studying Bible prophecy or salvation or the rapture or, you know, hell or heaven, we always use Scripture to interpret Scripture. Because I've had people come up to me and say, well, Pastor, your interpretation of that passage doesn't agree with the commentary that I read. Really? Really? It doesn't agree with the commentary that you read. Like the commentary is more important than the passage. You know who we criticize smugly as Christians? We criticize the Jews for that. Because that's what the Jews did. Jesus even rebuked them for that. He said, you have taken your father's traditions and you have nullified God's word. But we do the same thing. We, you know, and I'm not against Bible commentaries. I use Bible commentaries. And I'm not saying that you can't get some really cool insights from Bible commentaries. But let me tell you, the best, most powerful source is the actual Word of God itself. I'll give you an example of what happened. One time I was preaching out of the book of Acts, and I preached about the day of Pentecost, and it says right in Acts chapter 2, it says, and the Spirit was poured out upon all flesh. And this person who was big into commentaries came running up to me and said, well, my commentary said that it wasn't poured out on all flesh. And I go, really? That's what your commentary said? Well, guess what? My commentary, the Word of God, says that it was, that He was poured out on all flesh. You know, and I'm not saying that the commentary that this person was reading was useless. I'm sure there were great truths, but commentaries are not the Word of God. And I'll use one great person, a great man of God, as an example, Billy Graham. Billy Graham was asked a question one time. I don't know what the specific question was. I think it was something about reading books about the Bible and the Bible. And this is what Billy Graham said. He goes, I wish I had read the Bible more and read books about the Bible less. Okay? And I don't know about you, but man, Billy Graham, he ranks right up there he's not God. I don't worship him. But there's never been a controversy with Billy Graham. I mean, the man has walked with integrity. Is he sinless? No. He's a sinner, just like me. Needs salvation, just like me. But the integrity of his ministry is undeniable. And so when I heard that, it really pricked me. Because, guys, let me tell you something. I've grown up in the church. I've read a lot of books about the Bible. I have. You know, and I've gotten some good insights, and I'm not saying we shouldn't read books about the Bible, but if we're reading books about the Bible more than we're reading the Bible, there's something messed up with that. We need to be in God's Word. Okay? Well, anyways. So, but getting back to what Peter is saying, he said, you know, we saw Jesus transformed, illuminated, glorified, and that was really cool. But you know what? Our Bible prophecy that we have is even more important. Why? Because Jesus used Bible prophecy to show that He was the Son of God and is the Son of God. Because, you know, I'm going to tell you something. And people don't like it when I say this, but this is true. And I'm sorry that people don't like it, but it's absolutely true. Satan can do miracles. Satan can do miracles. Okay? I turn your attention to Matthew chapter 4, when Jesus was in the wilderness. What did Satan do? He did a miracle. He took Jesus to the pinnacle of the temple and said, cast yourself down. How did Satan take Jesus up to the pinnacle of the temple? Okay, they didn't have airplanes back then or jetpacks back then. How did he do that? Supernaturally. Okay, Satan also showed Jesus all the kingdoms of the world, all of them, not just the kingdoms of that day, but all the kingdoms of the world, the kingdoms of today and tomorrow, forever how much longer we have kingdoms. Okay, and Satan said, if you worship me, I will give all, he was trying to give Jesus a shortcut, okay, to be the ruler of this world. How did Satan do that? They didn't have, video projectors and internet. How did he do that? Supernaturally. In fact, the Bible says that Satan will appear as an angel of light. How does he do that? Supernaturally. See, in 21st century America, we're really not comfortable with miracles, are we? We're really not. We like to put God in a box. This is my God box. This is my manageable God, you know? And if your God's in a box, your God's too small. You know, my God can do things that no God can do. Because he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He had the first word, and he's going to have the last word. And he's the judge. He is the judge. And Daniel knew that. Daniel knew that. And so I just want to share some other things with you. Prophecy is something that we should pay attention to. Okay, there was a king of Israel, or actually of Judah, that did not pay close attention. And if you turn with me in your Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 32, Jeremiah chapter 32 and verse 5, Jeremiah was a prophet of God, and it was his job to warn the king of his time. And in Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 5, I'm having a hard time getting there. I thought I had a marker there, but I don't. Okay, here we go. Jeremiah was dealing with Zedekiah. Okay, this is a little bit later on from the chapter we just read. Chapter 1 of Daniel, Jehoiakim was the king. And some 19 years later, his uncle, Zedekiah, or actually no, one of his brothers, Zedekiah, became king of Israel. Okay, and his name was Zedekiah, and he was evil. And Zedekiah had made a covenant with the king of Babylon. He said, I will serve you. And he swore an oath that he would serve the king, King Nebuchadnezzar, okay? And he broke that oath. And so King Nebuchadnezzar, you know, he was just so upset and so done with these rebellious people that he decided, that's it, I'm going to end Jerusalem. I'm going to end this problem right here and right now. And Jeremiah tried to warn Zedekiah. If you look with me in verse chapter 32, let's start with verse 1 to get some context. It says, the word came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the 10th year of Zedekiah, the king of Judah, which was in the 18th year of Nebuchadnezzar. For then the king of Babylon's army besieged Jerusalem, and Jeremiah the prophet was shut up in the court of the prison, which was in the king of Judah's house. For Zedekiah, the king of Judah, had shut him up, saying, why do you prophesy and say, thus saith the Lord, behold, I will give this city into the land of the king of Babylon, and he shall take it. And Zedekiah the king shall not escape from the hand of the Chaldeans, but surely shall be delivered into the hands of the king of Babylon, and shall speak with him face to face, and see him eye to eye. What's going on here is Zedekiah is yelling at the prophet. How dare you say that I'm going to be handed over to the king of Babylon? That's treason. How dare you? And this is what the prophet says. In verse 5, then he shall lead Zedekiah to Babylon, and there he shall be until I visit him, says the Lord. Though you fight with the Chaldeans, you shall not succeed. So Jeremiah is telling Zedekiah, you're going to be taken away to Babylon, and you're going to stay in Babylon until I visit you. actually, he stayed there even after it. But you're going to be in Babylon, and then at some point in your captivity, I'm going to come and visit. Isn't that so cool of our God? Even though he's in the midst of rebuking this king, he's telling him, I'm going to visit you though. Because God does not want to destroy the wicked. He wants the wicked to repent. And we'll see in the scripture that that's exactly what God does. He does visit Zedekiah, okay, while he's in prison. Well, there was another prophet. His name was Ezekiel. And so if you turn with me in your Bibles real quick to Ezekiel chapter 12, Ezekiel also had a word from God for the king. And in Ezekiel chapter 12, verse 13, this is the word that God gave to Ezekiel. Ezekiel was already a captive. He was already a Babylonian captive. And he sends his letter back to King Zedekiah. And this is what he says to him. He says in verse 13, talking about the Lord. Actually, let's go drop up to verse 10 for context. So you know that I'm not speaking for God, that this was actually God speaking through the prophet. He said, say to them, thus says the Lord God, this burden concerns the prince in Jerusalem and all the house of Israel who are among them. Say, I am assigned to you, and as I have done, so it shall be done to them. They shall be carried away into captivity, and the prince who is coming, them shall bear his belongings on his shoulder at twilight and go out, and they shall dig through the wall to carry them out through it. He shall cover his face so he cannot see the ground with his eyes. I will also spread my net over him, and he shall be caught in my snare, and I will bring him to Babylon, to the land of the Chaldeans, yet he shall not see it, though he shall die there. So you have one prophet saying, I'm going to take you to Babylon in captivity, and I assume that he would be able to see, you know, the inferences that he would see it, or so it seemed. And another prophet saying, yeah, I'm going to carry you off to Babylon, and you're not going to see it at all. And you know what King Zedekiah did? He mocked the two prophets. He laughed at them and saying, you guys can't even get your word correct. Well, what happened to Zedekiah is a great testimony to us why we should pay attention. Turn in your Bibles with me to 2 Kings. 2 Kings chapter 25. 2 Kings chapter 25. Beginning with verses 5 through 7. Verses 1 through 4 tell us about Zedekiah fighting with Nebuchadnezzar, but all is lost. And so Zedekiah and his army, they break a hole in the wall and they start fleeing. They escape. They try to escape. Okay? But in verse 5 it says, but the army of the Chaldeans pursued the king, and they overtook him in the plains of Jericho. And all his army was scattered from him. So they took the king and brought him up to the king of Babylon at Riblah, and they pronounced judgment on him. Then they killed the sons of Zedekiah before his eyes and put out the eyes of Zedekiah and bound him with bronze fetters and took him to Babylon. That's how specific God was with this king. Because one prophet said, I'm going to make you go face to face with the king of Babylon. What happened? He tried to run and he got captured and he was brought face to face with the king of Babylon. But then what happened? His sons were killed and his eyes were plucked out, and he was put in chains, and he did not see the Babylonian captivity. Wow. Wow. You think, had Zedekiah listened to those prophets, he might have saved. I think the city was going to fall anyways, because God prophesied that the city was going to be handed over to the Babylonians. But maybe he and his sons would have had a much better deal before it was all said and done. To give you one more example, and we won't go into the scriptures to look at this, you'll just have to take my word for it and then study the scriptures yourself, okay? But if you look at the first century Jewish Christians, okay, the book of Luke chapter 21, and the book of Hebrews warn these Christians, don't go back to Judaism, Okay? And the book of Luke warned them, when you see the armies of the Gentiles surrounding the city, flee into the mountains. And you know what? That's exactly what those Christians did. Those Jewish Christians, they were being drawn back to Judaism because they felt separated from their Jewish brothers, okay? And they stopped. They didn't return to Judaism. And when they saw the Gentile armies surrounding the city of Jerusalem in 70 AD, but under the Roman leadership, there was a lull in the fighting, and during that time, the Christian Jews got out of there. Okay? And after they got out of there, then the Romans came in and they slaughtered over 1 million Jewish men, women, and children. And Josephus tells us in his writings that not one single Christian Jew suffered that fate. They listened to Bible prophecy, and it saved their very lives. But more importantly, it saved their very souls, because they believed that Jesus Christ was the Messiah who fulfilled over 300 Old Testament prophecies. And that saved them in a way of even more importance. Okay? And so you're saying, well, listen, aren't we going to get back to Daniel? Weren't we in Daniel? Yeah, we're going to get back to Daniel. And I do apologize, because I felt like I needed to give you this kind of a platform to work off of, so that you know where I'm coming from. Here in Daniel chapter 1, we have Nebuchadnezzar conquering Jehoiakim and Judah. And in verses 3 through 7, we see that Nebuchadnezzar brings his captives home. He brings his captives home, okay? We saw that in verse 3. It says, the king instructed Aspenaz, the master of the eunuchs, to bring some of the children of Israel and some of the king's descendants and some of the nobles, young men in whom there were no blemish, but good-looking, gifted in all wisdom, possessing knowledge and quick to understand, who had ability to serve in the king's palace, whom they might teach the language and literature of the Chaldeans. And so here the king is ordering his eunuch, his chief of staff, to bring in the noble kids and the royal kids of Israel, bring them to Babylon, teach them Babylonian literature, teach them the Babylonian culture, teach them the Babylonian science, so that they could become Babylonians. And you know what, folks? We kind of have a similar scenario going on today. We have our children taken from us to public schools where they're taught a different language, where Christianese is not spoken, where Christian principles are not venerated, not respected. And they're taught a language and a literature that is separate from us. The Bible is put down as a book of legends and myths, even though it's the most verified book in all of human history, even though it's the number one seller in all of human history, even though it has transformed the lives of probably 1 billion people, okay? And no other book has impacted the world like the Bible. And yet we have a false king carrying off our children into their capital, teaching them their science, which oftentimes is voodoo science. I'm telling you, some of the things that are passed off as science in our schools are not science at all. It's not scientific at all. Now, I'm not saying all teachers are like that, but I'm saying the overall general attitude. And you say, well, how can you say? I was a part of those government schools. I listened to the nonsense and argued with it. Got into arguments with whole classes over the fact that I did not believe that I came from a monkey or primordial ooze, or, you know, now I did not come from some alien from another planet who came and left seed on this. It's like these people, they give us a hard time because we say you got to have faith. They have faith. They've created a whole system of faith. And at least I have the Word of God to back up my faith. And you know what? I have real science backing up my faith as well. The fossil records do not back up the evolutionary account. It doesn't do it. It doesn't do it. The fossil records do back up a creation account. And do you know that every single culture in the world has legends about the universal flood of the world? And then we have Christians, well, maybe it wasn't a universal flood. Maybe it was only a flood where Noah lived. Okay, well, then that makes God a liar. Because God told Noah after the flood was over, I will never do that again. I will never flood the earth. Have we had floods since, local floods, since Noah? Yeah. So if that's the case, then God's a liar. And we know that can't be true. Because the Word of God says God is not a liar. He's the way and the truth and the life. Okay? So it had to be a universal flood. And you know what? The geology record backs it up, because you have fossils of fish on mountains. How did those fish get there? Through the water. That's how they got there. A universal flood. See, don't get me started. All right. Nebuchadnezzar brings his captives, and so they're gathered in the city of Babylon. And notice that these young men have names. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I believe in the original documents, the original scripture, that every name, number was put there by design of the Holy Spirit and for a reason. And when we look at the meanings of the names, you're going to see God had special names for these four special guys. Okay, the first one is Daniel. We already know what his name means. Daniel means God is my judge. That's so cool. You can't judge me. God's my judge. Okay, but look at the other. Hananiah means beloved of the Lord. That's cool. Mishael means who is like unto our God. Okay, that's a cool one. I like that. That's a challenge. That's like, yeah, who is like unto our God? Okay, what does Azariah means? The Lord is my help. Wow. But what does this evil king do and his evil world system? They rename them. Daniel is renamed Belteshazzar, and Belteshazzar means Prince of Baal. Really? I don't think so. Daniel was never a Prince of Baal. He was a man who God was his judge. And we're going to see that as Daniel stands up with integrity of righteousness that is it's unparalleled in some ways in many people. I'm jumping ahead. Shadrach means illuminated by the sun god. Really? Illumined as opposed to blessed of the Lord? No way. No way. Meshach, who is like unto the moon god? That's crazy. You know, that's like the people in the book of Revelation who say, who is like unto the beast and who can make war with him? And our answer is, we know. We know. Our God can make war with the beast. And there is no God like our God. So the moon god, he's a punk. Yeah, I said it. He's a punk. Okay, he's a little itty bitty god. Okay, created by the Almighty God. Let me tell you something. Do I believe that these false gods had supernatural powers? Yes, I do. I believe that there were demonic forces operating behind these idols that these people worship to fool people into thinking that they are real gods, but they're not. They're fallen angels, demonic spirits that rebelled against Elohim. Okay. An Old Testament name for God. And then Abednego, servant of Nego, the shining fire. Really? You know, shining fire, you know what that reminded me? Of Nahash. Nahash means the fiery one, the shining one. And we're going to find out that these four special boys, because they're probably teenagers. They're probably around 15, 16 years old when they get taken, carried away into captivity. They were probably influenced by one of the greatest revivals in the history of Israel under King Josiah. Okay? And so they had a good upbringing. And you know what, parents? That's why we should raise our children in the ways of the Lord. Because when you bring them up in the way... I'll tell you something, guys. I don't mean to brag, but I know that some ways I have an advantage over some of you because I was raised in a godly home. Were they perfect? No. But they did their very best. And I think for the most part, they did a pretty good job teaching me about God. They certainly let me know that without Jesus in my heart, I'm going to hell. Okay, that's kind of important. Okay? And you know what? That has given me an advantage because, you know, I have had my whole life to see the miracles of God. I do believe in miracles. I have seen miracles. I have participated in miracles, both as a recipient and someone whom God used in a miracle. And it's awesome. It's not the most important thing to me. You know, it's not what I pursue the most. I do pursue it. I want the power of God. I don't want a Christianity devoid of power. I certainly want a Christianity with full, but I really believe that as we preach God's word, the signs and the miracles and the wonders will follow. And that's why we preach the word of God here. And there have been signs and miracles and wonders that have occurred in this church. People have been healed of cancer. People have been kept alive even though they had 8 blockages. Amen. people have been delivered from this illness, that illness. Supernatural, I'm telling you, I'm not lying to you. People that were on death's door were brought back to life, okay, or brought back into life. They didn't die yet, you know. And so God is the one who brings the favor. You know, God's the one who brings the miracles. And so God brings Daniel into his favor. Okay, verses 8 through 14. And we know, look at verse 8. And probably if you have anything underlined in the book of Daniel, you should underline this verse. Verse 8. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's delicacies, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested the chief of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. You're saying, well, what does that mean? What are we talking about here? Well, Daniel was an Orthodox Jewish fella. Okay? And as an Orthodox Jew, he wasn't supposed to eat pig. He wasn't supposed to engage in drinking a lot of wine all the time. Okay? He was supposed to, there was a certain Levitical diet, okay, spelled out in the Torah. You know, there were certain animals they could eat and certain animals that they couldn't eat. And notice King Nebuchadnezzar, he's not a Scrooge. He took these young men, and he's giving them the king's delicacies. He's giving them the best of his best, which probably had a lot of pig, a lot of pork, and a lot of unclean animals. And Daniel, being a Jew, an Orthodox Jew, didn't want to defile himself. Because remember, this is still the Old Testament. This isn't the New Testament yet. He's still under the Old Covenant, and he's under obligation by God not to defile himself. And so he purposes in his heart not to defile himself. And that was the key for Daniel excelling in his career. Young people, if you're listening to me, you want to excel, purpose in your heart not to be defiled, but to serve God. And I'm telling you, you will excel. Does that mean you get famous and make lots of money? Not necessarily. But some do. But what does the Bible tell us? Whatever we find our hands doing, do as unto the Lord. And so as Christians, we should strive for the highest degree of quality in what we do. I try to, when I'm preaching a sermon, I try not to be boring. I want to be entertaining. I want to be correct. I want to be anointed. And most of all, I want it to be God's word, not my word. So that you can benefit and be encouraged. And so that those who don't know you can come to know you. Come to know him, excuse me. And so God brings Daniel into favor. And so Daniel goes to the head eunuch. He says, look, my friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, we're Jews. We don't want to eat the king's delicacies. Give us water and vegetables. Now, some people have taken this and say, oh, in order to be a good Christian, you have to be a vegetarian. That's not the point. Okay, that's not the point here. Okay, I can bring you to Colossians that tells us that all food is acceptable as long as we sanctify it through the Word of God and through prayer, okay? So don't think that you have to be a vegetarian to be a good Christian. Now, being a vegetarian might make you healthier, well, you know, but don't put spiritual significance to it where it's not there, okay? Nowhere in any of the Ten Commandments does it say, thou shalt be a vegetarian. Doesn't say that, okay? So don't try to make it say that. That's not the point. The point was they would have eaten meat, but they would only eat meat that was allowed by their belief in Jehovah. And chances are they probably wouldn't get that kind of meat in a pagan culture. So they just decided not, you know, instead of taking any chances, we'll just avoid all the meat and we'll just eat vegetables and we'll drink water instead of wine. And of course, the captain of the eunuch's like, dude, you put me in a hard pot. I love you, man. Okay, I think you're awesome. But if you show up all emaciated, it's going to be my head. And so what does Daniel do? Throw a hissy fit, pout, and start protesting? We want vegetables. We want water. We want vegetables. You hate us. You want to kill us. You don't like us. And get all freaked out? No, that's not what he does. What does he do? He says, look, test us. Test us. Let us for 10 days eat the vegetables and drink the water, and then put us up against the other dudes. And if we're emaciated and they look good, then fine, we'll eat the king's delicacies. But if not, then we'll do what And I believe that God supernaturally empowered those vegetables and that water, because that you read the text, you read it with me. What happened after the end of 10 days? They looked healthier and fatter than the other guys. And so God brings Daniel and his friends favor with the eunuch, the head of the eunuchs, and Daniel is determined that he will not defile himself, and because of that, God gives him favor in the test. Now, let me tell you something, folks. We love to hear testimonies. How many people love to hear testimonies? Love to hear testimonies. Guess what? You can't have a testimony without a test. Oh yeah, we want a great testimony. Yes, the Lord God delivered me from all these things. Well, guess what? You have to be under assault of all those things for the Lord God to deliver you. And I'm not here to put down anyone's testimony, because every testimony is cool. You know why? Because it's your testimony. You don't have to scale Mount, whatever the highest Mount Everest or whatever is the highest mountain, and then fall down and break 20, every bone in your body, and then miraculously be healed to have a testimony. Okay, you don't have to be a thug on the streets, running around shooting people and robbing things, and then get saved by. You don't have to have that kind of testimony. The greatest testimony is this: I was a sinner, and now I'm saved. That's the most awesome testimony. Okay? Because that's a testimony that will be told throughout all of eternity. Guys, the rapture is not the end. When we get to heaven, there's going to be reunions. And there's going to be testimonies. And we're going to be meeting up with all the people that we miss and all the people that have gone before us. And I think probably the most awesome time we'll have is when, if and when someone comes to us and says, you know what, because you said this, I'm here. Because you preached the word of God, I'm here. Because you showed love to your neighbor, I'm here. Because you were faithful, and you went to church, and you tithed, and you were obedient, and you were a good citizen, and you were nice to people, and because of that, I am here. I'll never forget an example, and I'm sorry if it's a repeat. It is a repeat, but it's just so cool. I used to work at a certain bookstore. I can't say it because I want to endorse one bookstore over another. But I used to work at a Christian bookstore in the area. And one day while I was working at this bookstore, this lady came in with three kids, and they're all towheads. They're all blondies, okay? And, she's shopping, and, I'm doing my thing, and she comes up to the register to pay for her items, and she goes to me, she goes, do you know who I am? And I look, see, now, I'm bad with names, so if I hadn't used your name in a long time, there's a good chance I might forget it. I feel so bad about that. If people had numbers, if we were all just numbers, I would remember those. Like, I don't forget numbers. I don't know why my brain works that way, but it does. But anyways, I'd never forget a face. I don't forget faces, okay? And so I'm looking at her, I'm going, you do look very familiar to me. How do I know you? You know what she said to me? She said, because of what you said to me, I started seeking Jesus Christ. I said, oh, what did I say to you? Because I still hadn't put the piece. She goes, I asked you to smoke pot with me, and you told me that Jesus Christ was your high in life, that you didn't need drugs. And I go, oh, you're the blonde girl that I had a huge crush on, that I wanted to date really bad before Wendy. I didn't say I wanted to marry her. I just said I wanted to date her, okay? And it was tough. I'm going to be honest with you. I had to go deep into my well of faith to say those words, because I really, really, really wanted to be with her. And I was so tempted to go out in the parking lot and light up that joint. And you know what? I could have justified it, said, well, it's just one joint. I've never done it before. And, God will forgive me, because he's a forgiving God. And he would. I could ask God to. But you know what? That was a critical point in her life, and the Holy Spirit gave me the fortitude to stand my ground, and I said, no, thank you. I give God all the glory. Because my flesh was like, you know? And God's Spirit gave me those words. And because of that one, it's not like I went into a 3-point sermon with title, thesis, conclusion, you know, like I do here every Sunday. I didn't even preach to her at all. I just simply said, Jesus Christ is my high. I don't need drugs. I can't do that. And walked away. And she went on her way. But you know what? God took it. You know, God used it. So you never know. You know? What else did God do? God bring Daniel and his friends through the test. Look at what happens. Go with me to verse 15. Okay? It says, at the end of the 10 days, their features appeared better and fatter in flesh than all the young men who ate the portion of the king's delicacies. Thus the steward took away their portion of the delicacies and the wine that they were to drink and gave them vegetables. And as for these four young men, God gave them what? Knowledge, skill in all literature and wisdom. And Daniel had understanding in visions and dreams. Daniel became a dream interpreter. Supernatural gifts. Okay? And if that's not good enough, it gets even better. I mean, they passed the test of the head eunuch. Now they're, after 3 years, they're brought before the king. And what happens when they're brought before the king? Verse 18 says, now at the end of the days when the king had said that they should be brought in, the chief of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. Then the king interviewed them, and among them all was none found like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore they served before the king. In all matters of wisdom and understanding about which the king examined them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers who were in all his realm. 10 times better. You know, there's a member on our U.S. Olympic team, Michael Phelps. He's a believer. And he's probably the best athlete in the world right now. And there are other athletes of world-class ability. There are other people that love Jesus that maybe not are well-known. But I do believe that we, the body of Christ, can be the cream of the crop. We can be like Daniel. We can have an integrity that will give us a standing with people. Because Daniel purposed in his heart, I will not defile myself. A simple, you know, directive. He was brought before the king of his empire. And this is not the last time he's going to be brought before this king. As we get into our series in the book of Daniel, we're going to see that Daniel is brought before the king time after time after time. And at great personal jeopardy, he launches out to represent his God, letting Nebuchadnezzar know that there is only one God, and that he is the one who establishes kings and kingdoms. He is the one that is intimately involved in the affairs of man. He is the king. You know, and I challenge you, go and read the book of Daniel for yourself. And look at how Nebuchadnezzar evolves in his relationship to God. Because in the next chapter, God does a great thing through Daniel, and Nebuchadnezzar gives glory to his God to a certain degree, to a certain level of accuracy. Then in chapter 3, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, better known as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they follow Daniel's example, and they present the king with another supernatural event. And he is so astonished, again, he gives glory to the God of Israel to even a higher degree than he did in chapter 2. And then in chapter 4, he goes to Daniel because Daniel was used by God in chapter 2. And in chapter 1, he goes to Daniel and says, hey, Daniel, I got something I need you to unravel for me. I asked my other cronies and they couldn't tell me. They probably, maybe some of them really knew what was being said, but were too afraid to say it. But not Daniel. And he gives even more glory to God. And in my opinion, he gets saved in chapter 4. Yeah, the book of Daniel is a great book of prophecy. But there was a man behind those prophecies, a man of great integrity. And although we may be facing gods of this world that want to take our children and re-educate them and take them away from, you know, our Christian heritage, we can trust that God will supersede that. I went through the public school system. Guess what? I made it. My son went through the public school system. We wanted to homeschool him, and he made it. And I'm not against homeschooling. I like homeschool. I think homeschooling is great. And a lot of the statistics seem to indicate in some manners, homeschool kids have a huge advantage over kids taught in the public schools. You know, and it seems to make sense because the classes I was in when I was in school, there were like 30 people in a class. You know, if you're homeschooling your only kid, your children, it's 1 to 1, 1 to 2, 1 to 3, 1 to 4, 1 to 6, you've got a big family. Okay, that's not 1 to 30. How much attention can a teacher of 30 kids give to 30 different kids? But how much attention can a teacher of 2 give to the 2? I don't know. But don't condemn yourself if you can't get your... Wendy and I, we wanted to homeschool our Davy. We really did. But God said, no. That wasn't... But know this. Know this. And we've talked about this in other sermons, and I'm going to wrap it up here soon. The steps of a righteous man are ordered by the Lord. Daniel was a righteous guy, but he was swept into captivity right along with the wicked. Okay? But his steps were ordered by the Lord. Daniel was supposed to be in Babylon. That's where God had him. And God has you where you are right now. Your steps, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, your steps have been directed by the Lord. Romans 8:28 says, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to His purpose." The question is, the most important words in that verse is, "And we know." That's where the faith kicks in. Okay? And then even more importantly, do you love God? If you love God, then guess what? All things are going to work together for your good. All things, your mistakes included. And I'm not telling you to go out and make mistakes. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying that when we do, and we will, because we fall short of God's glory, we have that flesh we battle with every single day. And when we fall short of God's glory, God's going to turn those mistakes around. Now, we need to repent. There needs to be repentance. I'm not saying you can just go along, sin, and, you know, and it'd be grace. God forbid, Paul says. But know this. If you are legitimately pursuing God, you're legitimately asking God to forgive you, He will forgive us. And I believe that this church, that we have not seen the best days yet. I believe that there's more to come. And we just need to stand firm, like Daniel. And we need to purpose in our heart as a church not to be defiled by the world. Doesn't mean we hate the world. Okay? It just means we won't allow ourselves to be defiled by the world. Let's pray. If you're a listener who doesn't know Jesus Christ, if you're not born again of God's Spirit, today's the day of salvation. Jesus could come back right now, and if He were to come back right now, and if you're not saved, you're going to get left behind, and you're going to have to meet the most horrible person this world has ever seen, the Antichrist. We at First Congregational Church don't want that to happen to you. And so we ask you, come to Jesus. Accept Him into your heart. And if you would just pray this real simple prayer with me, you can punch your ticket for the rapture on Airline Jesus. So just pray with me. Dear Jesus, I believe that I am a sinner. I believe that You are the Son of God. I ask You to forgive me for my sins, to cleanse me from my iniquities. Come into my life. Be my Lord. Be my God. Be my Savior. I surrender to You. I ask that you would do this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you did that for the first time, happy birthday. Today truly was your day of salvation. One last favor I ask of you. If you could just go and tell a Bible preaching pastor or friend, someone you trust, what you did. Tell them how you accepted Christ into your heart. Because there's something about speaking out what we do that builds up our faith in Jesus. Well, from the rest of us at First Congregational Church, we'll see you next week, and may God bless you. all the days of your life.